This Sunday is the last Sunday of Trinity, last Sunday after Trinity. In the olden days, this was traditionally the Sunday where you would start making your Christmas cake. Meeting us before they moved it from the end of November to mid-October, although I don't know whether the government is still recommending that you start making your Christmas cake now. But of course, it is always the time to prepare our hearts with excitement for coming joy, the coming of the Word made flesh, even Jesus Christ our Lord. And so let us prepare our hearts right now to receive that wonderful gift, the words of the prayer preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom their secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Let's also confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, to our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed Lord, who cause all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, help us so to hear, to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that through patience and the comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and forever hold fast the hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please sit, please.
The first reading is from the Book of Job. Job answered the Lord, "I know that you can do all things, and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, two things wonderful for me to know, which I did not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you declare to me. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. And the Lord restored the fortunes of Job. When he prayed to his friends, and the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. Then there came to him all his brothers and sisters, and all who had known him before, and they ate bread with him in his house. They showed him sympathy and comforted him for all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him, and each of them gave him a piece of money and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter days of Job more than his beginning, and he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He named the first Jemima, the second Kesil, and the third Karen Hapuch. And all the land, there were no women so beautiful as Job's daughters. And their father gave him inheritance with his sons. And Job lived 140 years and saw his children and his children's children 4 generations. And Job died old and full of days. This is the word of the Lord. Permanently. because it continues forever. Consequently, he is able for all time to save those who approach him, God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he has no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins, and then for those of his people. This he did once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests those who are subject to weaknesses. But the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout and say, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Many standing ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even louder, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." And they called the blind man, saying to him, "Take heart, get up, he is calling you." So, throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." Immediately, he regained his sight and followed him on the way. This is the word of the Lord. Land far, far away, named Oz, there lived a man whose name was Job. Oz is located beyond the Euphrates River in the southwestern region of current-day Jordan. In a population of millions in the world, I believe currently we're about 7.8 billion or thereabouts. In Job's time, maybe let's even say a billion. God singled out Job as the only trusted servant of his that he knew would withstand the triumph and persecutions of Satan. It is written that one day the angels came. came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. In what capacity, we are not told. And why God gave him audience, nobody knows. In one of my earlier sermons, I mentioned about our battles here on earth against evil powers and principalities. It is written that Satan declared to the Lord that he had been roaming throughout the earth, prowling back and forth. So Satan is powerful, he's here on earth, but God is divine and always means well. We visit the story of Job again. One of the bewildering stories in the Bible that reinforces the need for us to be very resilient with faith when we face adversities. Our psalm from today, Psalm 34, says we should extol the Lord. Every single verse of this beautiful psalm is exemplified by Job in his dealings with his ordeal. I have juxtaposed parts of the psalm in the sermon, and I hope you can spot them as we go along. He sought the Lord, and the Lord answered him. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. We are told Job was found blameless before the Lord. So much so, God was confident that he would prevail over evil as long as Satan does not lay a finger on him all his life. Satan visited Job twice. The first time he took out all he had. Not being satisfied, he went against God's word and touched his flesh. This wasn't the idea God had given. The book of Job explores how righteous people sometimes suffer, and this does happen. Job stood out amidst a free friend of his who, despite having started off by praising him for his righteousness, changed their story along the line and were convinced that his suffering was from his wrongdoings. Thus, they incurred also God's displeasure. Friends are great to have, but one shouldn't let them deride one or move one away from one's convictions. Peer pressure is real, even amongst adults. It takes a young man, a rival, to reinforce Job's uprightness, despite the wisdom, the age of all his three friends. It is good to believe in oneself as long as one's way is pure and true. And then one can confidently approach God's throne of grace. Job demanded of God reasons for his suffering, insisting at all times how righteous he had been, and very confident that he had done no wrong. The suffering gets so much to him that he cursed the day he was born, wondering why he was actually ever brought to life. Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, please do keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn from evil, seek peace, and pursue it. We should keep the images of the three wise Japanese monkeys in mind always. Sometimes I actually do meditate on them. Mizaru, Ikazaru and Iwazaru, they are called. See no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. Sometimes there is a fourth one, Cesaru, symbolizing do no evil. Job, the righteous man, called upon God, and the Lord heard him. Resilience in one's faith when facing adversity, we can see, requires a lot of strength of character. In the book of Job, there's a glimpse of Adam and Eve in Job's story. I don't know if anybody spotted that. He proved to be much stronger than Adam in rejecting the suggestion made by his Eve. He also resisted the three friends and clearly demonstrated his strong faith in God. Blind Bartimaeus, in our reading from Mark's Gospel, also demonstrated that same power of faith with confidence by refusing to be silenced. And this was acknowledged by Jesus Christ, the permanent high priest who has been made perfect and lives forever. He, Jesus Christ, is the pride of heaven. He is able to save completely. The more they tried to silence Bartimaeus, the louder he shouted, because he believed that only Jesus would do for him. The Lord will rescue his servants. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. We see how Job, at the end, is greatly rewarded by God. And given more wealth, we believe the most beautiful children in the whole world, and many more fruitful years on earth. A better life than his beginning. He was also the intermediary to the redemption of his three friends who had incurred the displeasure of God for their judging Job. Do not judge. God has a plan for everybody and everything. So, my dear fellow Christians, what adversity are you going through right now? I have mine. Life itself is about overcoming them. And worship content with them in faith, knowing that God is always in control. Job kept praising God and has given us knowledge about God's way in his, during his adversity. He never once belittled God, even though he could never rationalize, or he never rationalized why he was going through so much physical and emotional torture. But at the end of it all, he shines gloriously, and we never heard of Satan anymore, all through the narratives after. What sees us through is total submission to God's will, knowing that God is not wicked, and that he's aware of our sufferings, and that he's ever willing to redeem us through his Son, Jesus Christ. My initial plan was to end this sermon by ringing the traditional evangelist bell to alert us of the kingdom of God. Unfortunately, I couldn't find that bell. However, this is still a call out to every one of us not to lose faith, to behold the might of the Lord with trepidation, as he has the power to make and unmake. The wise will follow his commandments and live, and not just live, but live abundantly. Let us not carry our worries on our faces, but rejoice and glory in God. With the faith that we are overcomers, we are victorious, and that victory has been sealed through the blood of Jesus Christ. God bless you.
Together our faith in God in the words of the creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, which came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of life, love, faith, and hope. Thank you, Lord, for your grace, your peace, and steadfast love that we enjoy. We praise and glorify you for letting us dwell under your shelter. We pray for our homes and families, that you unite all in love and tolerance, that you teach individuals to accept each other's imperfections. Above all, we pray you give us all the resilience and an enduring patience to await your will in our lives. Strengthen our faith, belief, and hope in your word, and meet us all individually at the point of our needs. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for the whole world, that you let your peace reign, and help the world to make appropriate action in tackling climate change through your guidance during the coming COP26 Climate Summit in November, such that we rapidly move away from fossil fuels and make plans to clean up our oceans. We pray that you let the nations that are highly dependent on trade from fossil fuels see the need to engage and start planning for alternative sources of energy and income generation through and with assistance and cooperation from the superpowers. Help all nations to unite and abide in the decisions reached and be truly United Nations, as the name implies. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for your church, the clergy, lay ministry, all officers working in your ministry, and all Christians, that you guide and guard our thoughts, words, and actions, that you order our steps and let your wisdom, your knowledge, and your understanding be with us always, and that once again give us that resilience with strong faith to do your will always. Help us to serve you diligently with all the gifts, the talents, and the strengths that you have endowed us with. Open our spiritual eyes and ears, and assist us in winning more souls to you. Lord, in your mercy, we pray, Lord, that you rid the world of this COVID pandemic and reveal to the government, the public health professionals, all medical staff effecting treatment and vaccinations, and indeed, all individuals, the steps we need to take to limit the transmission and weaken the virus. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for all governments and leaders, that you let your spirit of philanthropy minister unto them, such that the reach and the policies of the government cater for the needs of the suffering masses and lift them out of poverty by providing for their daily needs. We pray for societies where kidnapping has become a lucrative business, that you help rid this evil and provide security and peace. In particular, we bring Nigeria, Haiti, before you, and pray you provide good leadership in these countries and empower the election of patriotic leaders that will correct the evil in these lands. Lord, in your mercy, we pray that you heal the sick, comfort the bereaved, and give peace to the dying. Eternal rest grant unto the departed dead body, and let your perpetual light shine upon them. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
pray for all those working in the arts, that they use their talents to express your covenants and great works. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Finally, we pray for St. Mary's at Finchley, its congregation, choir, officials, lay ministers, and the clergy, that you lead us all in our deliberations and help us to improve our services and dedication to your worship, so that we may win more souls to your kingdom. Merciful Father,
accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Please stand again if you're ready. We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life together. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise to your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us, giving wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. And so he fulfilled your will, and won for you our holy people. And therefore, the angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, and evermore praising you and singing. Took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me."
Grace is the mystery of faith.
Rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one your kingdom, all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Bartimaeus and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray with confidence that our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
That we are men, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Christ,
takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his Son.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you.
word of his kingdom. Renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all our weakness, sustain us by your true and living word, in the alignment now and for us. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and our bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. There will be coffee in the hall after the service as usual. We'd love some more volunteers for the coffee roasters, so if you think that's something you feel called to do or you'd just be happy doing, please do speak to me or Philip Warner, the church board, or Nick after the service and say volunteers for the coffee roaster would be greatly appreciated. But for all of us, there is, by God's grace, still coffee after the service. There'll be Zoom evening prayer as usual at 7 o'clock, and please drop me a line or Philip if you would like the access details for that. On the 1st of November, which is a week tomorrow, we will have our All Souls service, or the commemoration of the faithful departed, where we hold the remembrance before God, those who hold in our hearts who love and sing no longer. We will also be able to name people in prayer during that service, if you would like. There's a list at the back of the church for you to add names to, if that's something you might have. Thank you to all those who donated to our collection for Afghan refugees. I understand that raised £1,567.36. I'm sure that if you forgot about that and would still like to donate something, I'm sure there's probably still time. But that's a wonderful donation from Parish so far. The Winter Night Shelter will be starting this year, starting about now. It hasn't kind of come back to its pre-COVID fashion just yet, so we're not actually hosting it here as in previous years. But there is still a need for volunteers to provide and do various other things. If you would like to volunteer for the Winter Night Shelter, please speak to Penny Igo or again to Philip Wright. We can pass that on and put you in touch with them. The Winter Night Shelter has also been a sponsored walk. The details about that in our email newsletter. So we're financially supporting the Winter Night Shelter. I think that's all the notices now, so I hand over to the choir for our final hymn.
Thank you.
hearts and minds, in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.